somebody here.
Does it work, yeah?
Yeah,
yeah. So, good afternoon. My name is Josef Weidenholzer. I'm the sponsor, host, whatever, of this event. I'm very happy that Alex is taking over in a minute the presentation of this conference. It is a series of events in the Parliament. The first event we had last July on ad blocking. The second event is today. We are happy that we are more than last time, and we also have chosen a bigger room, so this is actually the second largest room of the Parliament, and it looks a bit very huge, so if it would be another room, it would be really quite a huge crowd. So thank you very much for coming. I have, unfortunately, to leave because I'm doing in parallel also the horizontal working group of the Socialists and Democrats group, and they're already asking that I'm joining them again. We just had Alex in our group meeting, and it was a very interesting, intense discussion with a lot of follow-ups, and I'm very, very happy about this. So, Alex, please continue. I hope I can be back on a later stage of our event today. So I hope that we have fruitful discussions today. Thank you.
Thank you, Joseph. Welcome, everybody. We've got some feedback. Is that coming from me? Everything okay? Okay. So as Joseph said, we had another session in July last year. We've still got some feedback. Thank you, Tom. No.
Made it worse.
Okay. No. That's better. Yeah, I'll use this one instead. No, that's no good either. We'll just deal with this technical glitch. But meanwhile, I'll just introduce everybody. So we have Roy Carthy from Shine Technologies on the left-hand side. We have Thomas
Mendrina,
who is a late addition from SourcePoint. Matt Atkinson, who was supposed to be attending, ended up being stalled in the US. So Thomas has very graciously agreed to come and take his place. He also works for SourcePoint, dealing with all their European businesses, as far as I'm aware. Yeah. We have Ben from IO, who are the company behind AdBlock Plus, and my MacBook's just having a hiccup. There we go. And we have Tom Bowman from the BBC, who's Vice President for Revenue Development and Operations at BBC Advertising. So thank you for joining us, Tom. As I said earlier, we had an event back in July 2015, and it was a shorter event. I think we only had about 90 minutes, and we had some delays at the beginning getting everybody settled down. So we decided that we were going to hold another event because we really didn't have enough time for a very comprehensive discussion. So we really wanted to host another event today, and of course it's Privacy Week here in Brussels. There's the CPDP conference going on starting tomorrow. We have International Privacy Day on the 28th. So from my perspective, it's a good time to be in Brussels presenting a debate on the issues around ad blocking. So we're going to start. We have an agenda, which is basically each of the speakers will give us a short presentation, around 10 to 15 minutes, on what they do and their opinions, at which point all of you guys in the audience have the opportunity to ask some questions. Then we'll have a short break where we can have tea and coffee, which I believe is at the top there, and then we'll get back after the tea and coffee break and we'll have a debate between everybody. And then towards the end of the session, about 15 minutes from the end, we'll open the floor to everybody else in the audience as well. So did we manage to sort out the... Give me a second, see if mine's working now. Are we still... No. So I'll have to keep using this one, which is fine. So that's basically it. Now, from my perspective as a privacy advocate, I've been working in this field for about 10 years now. And advertising has been my core focus. So the emergence of ad blocking technologies and other technologies from a privacy perspective is something I find very important and a useful tool for consumers to empower themselves and become more in control of their own privacy. Obviously, some people here have different opinions. I do like to try and keep the floor balanced, which is why we have stakeholders from all parts of the industry. And hopefully today will be an interesting discussion. So we'll start with Tom, if you don't mind. Would you like to introduce yourself and do your presentation?
Press that, see if it works any better than Alex says. Maybe it does. No, it doesn't, does it?
No.
Try it. No, that's even worse.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Now we're going to go stand on the other side.
You're just having a laugh, aren't you? Yeah.
So, actually, I've got a guitar. We can just do feedback. Yeah. Are you going to stick my slides up? Hello. You can't. Yeah. It will be the first one. There's one right up the top there with the BBC logo on it. If you can go to presentation mode, that would be good. Hello, so I work for BBC Advertising. This is ridiculous. I work for BBC Advertising. I'm just going to shout. Yeah? I work in the advertising industry, so shouting should be all right. Yeah? Advertising is a mass medium, actually. It's for reaching large numbers of people. It's actually a useless way of reaching a small group of people. It's a useless way of reaching individuals. So if I wanted to put a message across to you, everybody in this room, the one thing I would not do is advertising. Yeah? It would cost me a great deal of money to set it up, and it would be far more efficient to just come and talk to you, because there are only 20 of you. So that makes a lot of sense. So by definition, advertising is a mass medium. As long as it's existed, and I've worked in advertising for much longer than the internet has actually been operational or commercial, it's been a method of putting goods and services in front of human beings. And sometimes you want to tell everybody about your message, and sometimes you only want to tell people in the European Parliament about the message. Yeah? And sometimes your services or goods are only suitable for some people. So BBC Advertising is part of BBC Worldwide. We, for a long time, you've probably heard of the BBC, we deliver news on a global scale, we also make TV programmes and we send them around the world. Inside the UK, we're actually funded by what is effectively a subscription model. Outside of the UK, we're not allowed by our charter to use that method of funding our services. So if we wanted to reach the rest of the world with news information, our choice back in 2008, when it started to get a bit expensive, was to fund it with advertising. You could go on to the second slide if you like. And it don't work very well, so go on to the third slide. So the bottom line is it's incredibly simplistic to say that advertising, be it online or any other form of advertising, is actually bad, although you quite often hear people say that. Actually, advertising demonstrably oils the wheels of industry. It's one of the most efficient ways of letting...
You think it's going to work now? Oh, I've got a man waving at me. Yeah. Good man, thank you. I like the informality of it all, thank you. A friend over here is helping. Demonstrably oils the wheels of industry. Its purpose is to sell goods and services. That's why advertising exists. And it will happen. So if we muck around with this particular way of putting goods and services in front of consumers, then actually advertisers will use different ways. So if they find that the internet isn't a good way for them to market, they will continue to use television, continue to use the outdoor, continue to use radio, maybe go back to using print, I don't know. But what I do know is that badly executed advertising can be annoying and extremely intrusive, and most of us are victims of that, as well as also people who have enjoyed from time to time seeing exactly the right message at the right moment and have actually found out about something that they didn't know about before. Consumers should have choice And those choices that consumers have outcomes, very simple outcomes. So we can afford to fund our services one way, or we can use a different way. Those are some of the decisions that if you're trying to run a business, you operate. If you go on to the next slide, technology in today's world is often part of a solution. The world we live in, this meeting only came about. I can see Alexander here has got very expensive technology here, very flash technology, just like a bigger iPhone than mine. Yeah. You know, all these things have implications. They have apps on them. I found out what the weather was like in Brussels before I came here. You know, those are technologies that now exist. As we heard in the previous session, there's no such thing as a free technology. There's a relationship that takes place in the world of technology between the consumer and the person that's providing that information. And that relationship is one of the people that are running the service, one way or another, have to make a living. Many websites, when I first got involved with the internet back in the 1990s, were actually run for free. That's how they started. And when you could run a website on your own computer in your own back bedroom with a few hundred people using it, then it didn't really cost you anything except your personal time. When you run a website which has 100 million users, it actually costs a lot of money to run. It costs a lot of money on whether these days Amazon Web Services or other cloud services cost a lot of money to run. You cannot do that for nothing. So you have to fund it somehow. Some people have the wherewithal to pay you. Other people do not. Advertising kind of crosses the gap. There are commercial and there are consumer benefits here. If we go to the next slide. I put this one up because we're here to talk about ad blocking. We're here to talk about the bad side of advertising, which has existed. There are bad cars manufactured. There are bad advertising is made all the time. This guy's not looking at a bad ad. He's looking at something which he thinks is completely cool, absolutely superb, never seen it before, completely delighted by the experience. Guess what? That happens probably at least as much as people see things that they're annoyed by. When I worked for Saatchi & Saatchi, long before the internet did any kind of commercial activity, we were told when I was a trainee TV media buyer, we were told to make sure that the consumer got to see the message at least 11 times, because otherwise they wouldn't necessarily remember the message. We were also told, don't let the consumer see the message more than 18 times, because if you do, that will have a negative impact on the audience, and they might be slightly annoyed by that. And so we've been running our business that way ever since. Don't annoy the consumer, because it can actually put them off the product. So you can delight a consumer, or you can put them off a product. And in the world of goods and services and selling, that's the way in which it works. People who do the right thing do succeed, and people who do the wrong thing over time don't. Can we have the next slide? What we have at the moment is something of a technology war. It's brand new. Actually, ad blockers have been around for donkeys. They've been around for a decade at least. Yeah. Gamers used to use them because advertising appearing on sites with not so much bandwidth actually slowed down the online gaming experience. And so it's been around for quite a long time. But there's a technology war going on, and that technology war is going on between major players in the industry and between startups in the industry. And a technology war is not necessarily the solution. So what I put on the screen here is the website of a British daily news service, which was a free giveaway in the tube stations in London, if you've ever been to London, called City AM, which made its way onto the website. So it wasn't a pay-for system. It's a free newspaper that was given away, paid for by advertising. In today's world, this is a free newspaper which exists on the web, paid for by advertising. Same thing. Then they found that quite a lot of their audience stopped coming because they downloaded ad blockers. But when they asked their audience to stop doing that, a quarter of them agreed to going back to the previous way of doing things. But I don't think this is any sort of solution whatsoever. Can we go to the next slide? On the same panel as us this afternoon, my friend from ABP It's not a technology war, because in a technology war you can win battles, and maybe City AM won that battle. They got a quarter of their users seeing their advertising again. They could stay in business. But here's a second part, the other side. A technology war is not the solution, because the consumer loses here. In this instance, the message from the publisher, which says, please don't use ad blockers, or if you do, we can't run our business and we might have to charge you a subscription instead. The actual message itself that is asking the consumer whether or not they want to undo the ad blocker is being blocked by the ad blocker. Because what we're actually looking at here is a technology war. None of this actually benefits the consumer at all. At this point, if we go to the next slide, we should talk about how we think about it at the BBC. So, at the BBC, outside of the United Kingdom, where we're not funded by charter and by a licence fee and by a whole bunch of people, because actually the BBC, I guess you could say, is actually owned by everyone who has a TV licence, advertising is a revenue stream which enables us to inform and educate and entertain audiences globally. We've chosen that's the way to do it. We've chosen the route we should do it is free at the point of consumption, which actually ensures maximum access. One of the things you can think about is that across the planet, billions of people are not really in a position to pay. Yeah. And so you can't really see the graph because the screen doesn't make it big enough. But the graph shows the difference between the number of Apple apps, so on Alexander's phone there and on my phone, Apple-based ones, iOS ones, the number of ones that actually have been served, which, and the number of Android ones, which is the other main service, yeah, which is the green bar. So in the world, outside of Western Europe and North America, there are far more Android devices than there are Apple devices. But the right-hand chart shows how many are paid for. And far more people pay for Apple apps than pay for Android apps. Because around the world, not many people have the wherewithal to do so. And actually, in some places where we deliver news services, you don't really want to subscribe to things, because maybe you, if you're in one country reading about what's going on in another country, you don't really want to have to register or subscribe to find out the information because of privacy, and we care a great deal about privacy. So the advertising business has actually enabled us to run this on a global service. So that's what we're actually risking here if we don't get the advertising industry correct. So although in Western Europe it's quite comfortable to think, oh, everyone could just pay a subscription instead, yeah, they'd still have to put their data across, and you would actually be shutting the door on large numbers of people being able to receive the information. Don't believe me? Just believe the figures about apps. Yeah. And of course, nothing's free. The app people who don't get paid for by subscription, which is a nice choice you can have, I can choose to take the advertisements off my weather app by signing in and paying a subscription fee. Yeah. When I do that, a person collects an enormous amount of data off me. Actually, a lot more data than they have if I didn't do it. However, I benefit if I choose to do that, because I've chosen to not have an ad appear just at the moment when I'm trying to work out what the weather is, or when I'm trying to check out what time the bus is coming or anything like that. But I, as a consumer, have the option to do one or the other. This is a good thing. Yeah. That choice is a good thing. Next up, next slide, please. Second thing for the BBC, really, is that our position is that there is very genuine public concern with no universal way to control cookies across the internet. That's a proper concern. This is our second piece is that user trust is actually central to the BBC. So our aim, since we decided to run our business commercially outside of the UK since late 2007, is to provide all our users very clear choices in relation to their data. Even before the cookie directive, we had that running on our service, and we believe that that's correct. We also aim to make our site operate at the right sort of speed, because part of the weight on a website is actually the advertising. In fact, unless it's a very visual website, the advertising can actually be the largest part of the weight of this, which can actually slow the site down, which is not necessarily a brilliant thing if the consumer is paying a data charge. So if you're very, very concerned about your consumers, then you're concerned about the performance of your site as an aspiration. Then we actually also believe that there should be a clarity between what is an advertisement and what isn't an advertisement. Now, The BBC runs TV advertising services as well, and we're regulated by Ofcom in the United Kingdom, and it's against the rules of Ofcom, up to and including losing your TV licence, to run a message which isn't clearly shown as being an advertisement. That sort of regulation is the sort of thing that should be a good idea in the digital space as well. But if you're running a new service which is trusted for its impartiality, you'd be really foolish if you let commercial messages on the site which weren't clearly commercial. So that separation is one of the things that we care about. We also care very greatly about protecting our users from malware. And it is certainly the case that malware is something which can be delivered onto people's computers through advertising systems if not run properly. But actually, if you go to Africa, you can catch malaria. And so my way of thinking about malware is it's well described. It's something of an illness, but you can also inoculate against it. So we've got a couple of systems running on our site which actually catches that stuff and stops it getting anywhere and blocks the advertising. Technology is an incredible thing. It's often the solution to the problem. So you just inoculate the systems. So as long as you're being sensible about how you run your advertising systems, about how much weight they spend, if they have any impact on the site loading, and whether or not they deliver malware to your audience, that'd be really, really bad to come to the BBC site and end up getting malware as a result. That would be a bad thing. Now, that is possible because we live in a technological world, but we work really hard to stop it. So therefore, we think about the overall user experience. Because actually, advertising, as far as we're concerned, is a means to an end. It funds our ability to deliver information around the world free at the point of access. So that would be the job that I've been doing for the past several years. And this whole debate, I think, is really good. So if we could go on to the next slide. This whole debate is really interesting because it's actually provoked a whole lot of innovation. And this is one of the things which is really good and really creative. And one of the things which I've heard coming from the European Parliament and from the European Council and the whole time I've been involved with the internet advertising business, is one of the key things which is really good for Europe is actually innovation. And so innovation is coming. So for instance, one of the world's largest advertising medium, Google, have actually set about doing something called accelerated mobile pages, which is to make sites work much better. Because a lot of the problems that we're experiencing with websites and how well they work is because people are now using mobile devices rather than desktop devices, and the connections aren't as good on mobile devices. So that websites that were built for desktops actually run pretty slowly. And if you put advertising on them, they run even more slowly. So how about catch up a bit? So accelerated mobile pages from Google's, another company, Facebook are doing something called Instant Articles. Apple have got something called Apple News, which you'll find if you've got the latest browser version of Apple, it's already automatically on the system. All these people are here to develop instant solutions. However, they're also businesses, and there are controls that have got nothing to do with the conversation we've got going on here amongst those services. And so in a commercial world in Europe, we actually also, in my opinion, this wouldn't be the BBC's opinion, this would be my opinion, it would be better for the consumer if there was more choice and if British and German and French services also ran freely and actually could succeed. And advertising has got a lot to do with how those businesses are funded. So you see a non-big American player example underneath. The Financial Times, adopting a culture of subtraction to boost page speed. One of the key reasons, you might hear it on the SourcePoint presentation, and you might hear it from the ABP presentation, you might hear it from the Shine presentation, as well as privacy concerns. One of the key reasons why people decide to use ad blocking, which they have every right to use, is things don't work fast enough. Yeah. So commercially, people are adapting in a very positive way. Innovation outside of blocking. So the advertising industry itself, lean. Yeah. Light, encrypted for security purposes. Ad choice supported so that users are absolutely faced with the opportunity to choose whether or not they want to be, whether or not cookies are allowed to use, and non-invasive ad formats, getting away from the world where if you swipe on the phone, you accidentally click on the ad when you didn't need to, just because we've moved across to a new device faster than the ads have caught up. And so what I think is really great about this debate is that instantaneously, because this is a very fertile creative industry, solutions are arriving. The next slide, please. That we have to think about what we really want here. Ad blockers are actively encouraged by privacy campaigners. This is the subject this afternoon. So I know exactly what my chairman will think. I've read enough about what he says. Yeah, that's how he thinks. That's fair enough. From our perspective, we understand that the use of an ad blocker may be an expression of privacy choice, and we respect that choice not to be tracked. In fact, we enable it on our services. But that doesn't equate to the need for the fully blocking of an advertisement or the full end of that ecosystem, because that advertising-supported ecosystem has a huge number of benefits to consumers. Actually, although very few consumers say they like advertising, most consumers will say that they like finding out about new goods and services. Yeah. Take it from me. It doesn't have to be what I put there as a B2B commercial solution either. What I mean is that a relationship between the websites and some technology. It can actually be at a consumer level. Yeah. So no one wants to spend their time setting cookie choices all the time they visit sites. If you've ever visited the European Parliament's website and tried not to agree accept cookies, you know what the experience is like. Yeah. If you've ever visited the Dutch websites and you find what the actual operational experience is like, no one wants to do that. So the answer is not a commercially determined system as to whose ads can and can't be seen. And don't be fooled. If anyone in this room thinks that the word ad blocking means that if you use an ad blocker, you don't see ads, then you've got the wrong idea. If you use an ad blocker, you see the ads that the ad blockers want you to see. And they have a commercial model where they're deciding which ads should be allowed to. So has the consumer been left in control in that situation? Or has it just been another player who's decided, have they decided what right I have to see which ads I want to see? Or do I get the choice as to which ads I want to see? Which way round should that be? That I just end up paying someone different? Yeah. Has actually improved the consumer's life? So now the website's making less money because it's paying money to somebody else? A random sort of choice. Yeah. Judge and jury on the industry. Brilliant. That's really great for the consumer. So what I would suggest is something a lot more positive, which is the next slide. Next slide. Sorry, my dear. Siri's not keeping up. A TV quality of rules for online. In fact, I'm really surprised, since I work on TV and on digital at the BBC, that the TV rules remain far stricter than the ones for online. I can't see why we can't just carry them across. Websites, I think, would be really great if they got to a place where they actually showed to the consumers how fast they were loading and had some sort of feedback loop so the consumers could say, well, you say you're loading that fast, but that's not my experience. Tools so that the consumer could actually decide whether or not they're in a real hurry or not that day, but could still respect the fact that they know how the websites are actually funded. They don't particularly want to pay a subscription. Yeah. So dynamically managed settings, not hidden. Some people, I would totally agree that some people actually do have, if you dig deep enough in the terms and conditions, you can find how to do something. Actually, bottom of the page, why isn't it top right? So some sort of gold standard. What I also say is that if websites collectively came out with a gold standard for their performance and their operating, then a lot of advertisers would appeal to that. Would like to be seen on sites that operated to such a gold standard. That's how this business works. Yeah. Quality advertisers gravitate towards quality services. Online advertising competes with TV advertising. Yeah. It competes with print advertising. It has to provide a quality service. It's not a quality service if its consumers get malware. So all those things are actually part and parcel of how you run a proper business. So it's great that this debate is here, but that's why I describe this conversation as growing pains for the industry, not really Armageddon. Just a few things have to change. And the really good news is a lot of innovation has come really fast. The trade body's doing stuff, commercial businesses are doing stuff, and even the other players here are actually moving things along. A lot of that was Tom Bowman's personal point of view rather than the BBC's point of view. But I've been doing this since 1995, so I guess I would have a view. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. I'm just going to ask a couple of questions and then we'll give everybody else in the audience a chance to respond to Tom. Tom, you mentioned at one point that the BBC on their website, you immunise against malware. And I respect that. I think that's a really good idea. But I think the comparison between somebody going to Africa and contracting malaria is somewhat different to how it works in reality. Whenever anybody goes or plans to go to Africa or somewhere where malaria is a likelihood to occur, they go to their doctor and their doctor immunizes them. They go with the knowledge that there's a chance that they could catch malaria. I would say that 99.9999 recurring percent of the people who visit a web page would have absolutely no idea that there's a chance that their browser is going to be hijacked by malware and be used for identity theft and fraud.
Well, long before the advertising industry actually really existed, and long before I think I came across my first instance of online advertising malware about 16 years ago. But before that existed, companies such as Norton Antivirus and McAfee and various other services existed, so that because actually, I'm afraid the internet is an expression of human beings, and people do bad things, quite often because they think they're funny or what have you. But long before the online advertising industry was really an industry, the first year I was involved in online advertising, I think the business I was working for made about £50,000, 1995. Yeah. Long before then, there were antivirus software systems which you could put onto your computers, and they exist right now. Advertising is not the only delivery system for malware. It is one of them.
It is one of them, and in a report released by Google just a couple of days ago,
800 million ads.
800 million ads removed.
Yeah. Some of the ones that have got near our site come from a variety of systems. One of those systems we use actually comes from that company. I'm not saying one way or the other, but actually, you only need to inoculate in one way if you're going to Africa against malaria, and you might still catch it. Even though you've been inoculated. Actually, if the consumer's got antivirus software, if the website is running its own systems, and if big companies are also running their own systems, I'm afraid this is software. It's almost impossible to defeat. Even if there was no advertising whatsoever, malware would still arrive on people's computers.
I agree completely. Let me finish what I was saying. The vast majority of people are not aware that malware exists in advertising. The BBC are one of very few publishers who take any active steps to prevent malware. Most publishers, particularly smaller publishers, simply insert a piece of JavaScript on the website and the ads are pulled down. So, whereas I strongly...
Actually, I don't agree with you.
Well, I've worked in this industry for 20 years, since before the web existed, so whether you agree or not doesn't make me incorrect.
No, well, you obviously haven't encountered the media trust and businesses like that for whom 60% of US companies are actually running.
Can I finish? I gave you a long time, so please allow me to finish.
Yes, but facts are actually important.
Please allow me to finish.
I don't know if I want to.
Antivirus software is playing catch-up. Antivirus software doesn't know malware exists until it gets reported. Until it gets reported, okay? So some people are always going to be infected by malware because until they are, the antivirus software doesn't even know that malware exists. That's the way antivirus software works. It works based on signatures of particular patterns of software which are detected and then reported either automatically or by individuals to the developer of the antivirus software. So the fact that the BBC takes steps to immunize is grand, but the vast majority of web publishers out there simply do not. And that's why malvertising is becoming such a big issue. And this is a growing issue, not something that's in decline. It's increasing significantly.
So,
in the last year alone, we've seen dozens of reports of major malvertising.
Would it be possible for malware to be delivered by an ad-blocking system?
By an ad-blocking system?
Yeah.
It depends on the ad-blocking system.
But would it be possible for it to be delivered the same way?
It depends on the ad-blocking system.
Yeah. So in the same way as it depends on the advertising system. So you could put an ad blocking system on, and it could be infected with malware, and that could deliver onto the consumer's PC. You would agree that technically that's possible?
Technically it's possible, but most ad blocking software out there is open source and is audited by the community. So the chances of that happening would be remote. It could happen, but it would be remote. It isn't remote in the advertising world. It happens on a daily basis. So that's the difference. Yeah, sure, Roy.
Sorry, just to interject from the only company who actually has real expertise in cybersecurity and malware. We were actually founded as an anti-malware company to reinvent the antivirus for mobile to deal exactly with what Alex was saying about signatures. In fact, we developed technologies, algorithms, artificial intelligence that is able to detect malware without signatures. It's like kind of a disturbance in the force type of stuff. Then we discovered, and this is sort of my comment here, rather than argue how and from what channel can malware be delivered, which is everywhere, is the fact that advertising behaves exactly like malware. That's why we made the shift. So you guys can argue about the delivery system, but ad tech even the stuff that you use, every single piece of technology that you guys use behaves like malware. So just let that settle for a bit.
Well, one critical difference, I make a living out of advertising. I don't make a living out of malware.
But other people do.
But yes, what you need to understand, and this is the main point, one of Shine's main points, is that ad tech abuses consumers. And while you may be a good person, the technologies you use abuse millions and apparently billions. I'm not really sure how big your audience is, but hundreds of millions of consumers around the world, whether be known or unbeknownst to you. But that is a fact.
Wow. Okay. Another point I wanted to raise is with regards to the use of tracking technologies. Now you mentioned cookies, but we all know that cookies are certainly not the only technology which is used to track people's behavior online. So things like device fingerprinting or server-side fingerprinting, flash cookies, canvas fingerprinting, there are so many technologies out there now which are able to be used to track the activity of people across multiple websites as to be just mind-blowing. And certainly the technicalities of that wouldn't be appropriate for this debate. But needless to say, they exist, and cookies are the least of our concerns in that market. The problem I have with regards to these tracking technologies is with regards to blocking ads. By blocking the connection to those servers in the first place, from a privacy perspective, those technologies can never be used. And this is why I recommend ad blockers as a privacy advocate, as a means for people to take control and empower themselves with regards to privacy. So in order to prevent that, those third-party services ever connecting to the user's device, it seems the only way we can do that, because there are so many circumvention technologies out there now, is to block that connection in the first place.
Perhaps you weren't listening when I said that we totally respect the choice of the consumer to use ad blockers if they want to. I think I said that. I think you'll find that what I actually said was that I'd much rather the consumer had the choice over what they did, and the choice was with them as to whether or not they wanted to receive no ads, some ads, or how they wanted to operate, rather than be in a situation where ad blocking technology companies actually decide that only the ads that they want to run should appear on our service.
But you understand that you've just generalized a number of companies here. Our company does not actually choose. We have no policy. You may be referring to your the colleague sitting next to you, not your colleague, but the gentleman sitting next to you. I'm sorry. Sure. Is this on? Yeah. Yeah, sorry. What I was saying is that ad-blocking companies in general do not behave like that. I think that's clumping up a certain behavior of a certain company, IO, over here to generalize a number of behaviors. My company, Shine, does not behave like that in any way, shape, or form.
So
I'm glad that you agree
that
consumers
can block.
So,
Roy, I think I won't take any lessons in generalization from you, since you just characterized the entire advertising technology industry as exactly the same as malware, which I think is a generalization.
That is technologically a fact.
So that's every single
so
ad technology
get your
company
IT guys
that exists
to look
in the world
is
a malware company. Okay.
I'm sorry, say again?
I said, so every single ad technology company in the world is a malware system.
No, what I'm saying is that every single advertising system behaves in a manner that malware delivery systems behave. They are designed to track and target consumers, individuals, people, kids, folks like us, elderly. That's their design. They are military intelligence systems souped up for commercial purposes.
Okay.
I know that's uncomfortable to hear, but that's a fact.
I'll just add something here as well. I've just visited the BBC's website, bbc.com, which is the commercial BBC website. I haven't agreed to any banners. I didn't go beyond the first page, yet the BBC are using the cache, cookies, and local storage without my consent.
Yeah. So you've presumably been there before because
no,
if you've
no, never been to the BBC's website. It cleared my browser before I went there as well.
No, well, it should have loaded a consent thing.
Oh, it's loaded the banner, but I haven't consented.
No, consent bar at the top.
Yeah, but I haven't consented. But those cookies, cache, and local storage have still been used, despite the fact that I haven't clicked on any acknowledgement or made any decision as to whether or not to consent to the placement of those technologies on my system.
Yeah, so it hasn't actually given you the opportunity to say no to any advertising, because that's not where we are at. We haven't reached that point. If you looked at my slide, it says we are aspiring in that direction.
But under the Privacy Directive, under Article 5.3, it specifically states that you shouldn't place any technologies on an end-user's terminal equipment until such time as they've given consent.
Yeah, so it's appeared on the site on the wrong way round. So that's, I do apologise, Alex. I'll make sure.
This isn't something that's localised to you. This is a problem we have with cookie banners across the internet. Oh. All these publishers are putting cookie banners on their websites, but irrespective of whether you go further than the homepage of that website or you click on any button on that banner, the cookies are still placed. Yeah, so despite the fact that they have these banners on there, it's a sleight of hand. The cookies are still placed.
Well, it isn't quite so, because actually to retain the fact that you've opted out, we have to put a cookie on the site anyhow, so there's an, because otherwise we don't know that you've actually opted out. So that's there isn't a way of delivering the system without using cookies at the current time. You may not disagree with, you may not agree with me, you may say there are all kinds of other technologies,
I completely disagree.
If you click on the option to opt out, you'll be given every single system that we operate, and you can opt out of one or all of them, and from then on, as long as you don't then wipe your cookies, we will know not to target you. If you then wipe your cookies, and the problem with the system is that many corporates actually wipe cookies all the time anyway. The problem is the system is that when you then go back, you have to do it again.
But Tom, with respect, you shouldn't be placing those cookies in the first place without having some form of affirmative
action. Don't have a delivery system to do that.
Well, yes, you do. It's quite simple. A JavaScript could be placed on the website, which prevents the loading of further JavaScripts until such time as a consent button has been clicked. But it's very, very simple technology. Very simple technology.
Okay,
so the excuse that there's no way of delivering it is simply not valid. There's no way that's currently being used to deliver it, but that's because the industry wants to maintain the status quo, and they're using sleight of hand to pull the wool over everybody's eyes, thinking that these banners actually mean anything, whereas the reality is they're putting the cookies on there anyway, whether you consent or not. And this isn't limited to the BBC. This is across the industry as a whole, something I've been observing and monitoring for some time now.
So
yes, there are technologies which can be used effectively. They're currently not being used. Anyway, we'll have a longer debate on this afterwards. We'll go to this side of the room. We'll go to Thomas next, and then we'll have the ad block people in the second session, second part of the session.
Click the button. Perfect. Wonderful. Can everybody hear me? Unfortunately, I'm the only one who is non-English speaking, so I have a German accent, sorry for that. Hopefully you can still follow. My name is Thomas Venrina. I'm from SourcePoint, which is a small startup. We started in 2015, several months ago. And what we try is to solve the issue of the ad blocking also for the publishing houses. Some of them, they have a real issue to monetize their content, and they fear to get thrown out of the market, and this is where But they were asking me, when I was using for Google, they were asking me, oh, if there's something that you can do, big Google, can you do something against it? Because if nobody's doing anything against it, then we have a real issue. And that's why a company was started. Next slide, please. That's why we started a company. Can you hopefully see that? It launched in 2015. Some offices, the idea is really, can you see that, hopefully? Yes, kind of that. Well, I mean, I'm around later on, so you all get a presentation if you want to. We are some people with publishing background, so I fully understand what Thomas is referring to, also with ad technology background, so we're coming from this angle. And you have 20 employees, so it's not that we have 200, 400 employees and engineers working on a solution. But we take a different approach. What we try to do is to bridge the gap between the privacy and the advertising ecosystem. Next slide, please. So what we see at the moment, and I'm generalizing, that the ad blockers, they control the default settings. So what Tom already mentioned, if the ad blocker decides which ad to show, which JavaScript to show, which video to show, which ad to show, which content to show, then they can do that. They are technically able to interfere heavily with the content. And the issue with that the publisher are suffering. The publisher, they are losing the control over their own content. They are losing the control over their own advertising, and they are losing the control over the monetization. We heard a lot about privacy, and what we know is that especially for some Apple Plus, for example, the users using the privacy list. Privacy list means that blocks all privacy related tracking. It's only a single digit number. So let's assume 100% are using AdBlock, AdBlock Plus, for example, only a single-digit number using the privacy list, which means that 90, 92, 95, whatever the percentage might be, depending on the country of the user, they use an AdBlocker, but they are not, they don't really have a privacy issue. So they do use an AdBlocker for other reasons, because page load, because maybe they don't like to be interfered with the ad is sometimes annoying for some of the websites, and 8%, 6%, 7%, they have privacy and tracking concerns. So we're talking, even if I like the very academic discussion about where a cookie is set and what the user is interested in, it's still a minority of the user using an ad blocker. And the other ones, the 1992, they would be okay with being tracked. They would be okay with seeing an ad, maybe even. And this is where we're going to. We try to close the gap between all the privacy issues and privacy subjects and how to still make a publisher survive in the actual situation, because if 60, 70, 80% of the user use an ad blocker, there is no way to survive for a publisher. There's no way to pay the editors, and there's no way apart from subscription to really to monetize the content. And one big obstacle in all of the ad blocking solutions that are out there, the default settings is normally unchanged. So yes, in the AdBlock Plus, you can whitelist a publisher. You can say, yes, I think advertising in general is bad, but for this website, I really appreciate the advertising. But there's not so many people doing that without being forced doing that. There are not so many users doing that. For some of the network blogs, there's even no chance. So if a network decides, okay, the entire network is going to be without any ad, apart from the ones that we maybe allow, then there's no way for a user to overrule that. So it's not user-centric at all. It's not user-centric. The default setting is not, they're normally not changed. So the responsibility of the ad blocker is huge and immense. And if we say ad blockers, they don't track, that's always not the case. I know that something happened with remarketing lately, also for AdBlock Plus, they used to block all the ads. Now they're moving those from an opt-in to an opt-out. So even if you don't want to be followed by not-so-nice ads, you're still followed by not-so-nice ads, maybe not-so-nice text ads, because now the text ad is showing you that you visited a website and watching a nice shoe, and not a graphical ad. But still, it's the same kind of annoyance that the user does not want. And now they still appear. They get followed by the ad. So you see, the ad blocker, they have a lot of control, and they really control the default settings. And if you control the default settings, you control the market. And this is what we're talking about. We're talking about who's taking with part of the revenue to from out of the advertising. We were here from Ben afterwards about the acceptable ads program, which is a nice program. So a publisher can pay, or you can. Some publisher get it for free, and then ads are going to appear. But it's a rev share model, so everybody is incentivized to allow more ads and to allow more tracking and to allow more ads that are following you through the internet. So there is always the concern about privacy. I understand that. We really try to close the bridge, and we're going to that later on. But don't get distracted by 8-10% of the user. AdBlock is not only about that. It's about an economical fight with some of the companies here and the publishing houses. Next slide, please. So we started SourcePoint because the publisher contacted us and said, well, we don't have any option to control the content anymore. There is no way for us to control the messaging to the user. There is no way to restrict content to restrict the access to the content. We don't know what to do with those AdBlock users. We don't have any revenue with it. It's 30% of our costs, 40% of our traffic costs, but there is no revenue. So what shall we do with it? So they tried to show a message. The message got interfered by the AdBlock, by some of the AdBlocking plugins. So it's a real obstacle for publishing houses to interact with their own users that are coming to a website reading, want to read the content. So what we try to achieve is that the publisher still gains back the control over the visitor, and there are ways in order to give the user the option to contribute a website. So first of all, it's about analytics, how to measure, how many people are blocking an ad. Then it's about the messaging to enable a steady communication path to a user. Also about recovery. So if a user wants to see an ad instead of paying a subscription, this should be possible technically. But for sure, all around the user choice, so the user should make their own choice how to compensate a publisher for reading the content. So it's not about the ad blocker doing the choice, but then what's happening, that there's a content log. The user with an ad blocker will not be allowed to read the content. Because if there's somebody eating your lunch, then for sure you say, well, maybe you should contribute and pay at least the drinks for this wonderful website. And for sure, a subscription model is also part of it. So what we try to achieve is at least that the publishing houses, the content producer, are in the same level of control compared to the ad blocker. And this is why we founded this company. Next slide, please. And there's only one way to gain control is to restrict the access to a website. And you all know that some European websites did that. So when you're using AdBlock Plus or another ad blocker or even network blocker, there's a message, well, please think about subscribing to our services, and then you're happily free to read our content. But without it, there's no way. So to force the user to give him at least a choice to read the content, that's very important, and to give him the choice to contribute and to compensate the publisher for the user. Because when one of the Axel Springer publishing websites started with the content log, they had a lot of calls from companies, from users with a company blocker, company ad blocker, that didn't even know that they have an ad blocker, and then they called them, well, unfortunately, I cannot visit the website anymore. Is there anything I did wrong? So some percentage of users don't even know that they have an ad blocker because they have company blocks. And some users, they would be very happy to accept an ad to not pay money to read the content. But what's going to happen in the next month is that more and more websites are going to content lock this. They would say, well, if you have an ad blocker, you only cost us money. Unfortunately, there's no way for you to read the content. And it's also important to educate the user that the production of content costs money. And there is a need for a publishing house to generate some money with the singular users. So educate users is very important. Communicate to the audience, but also allow users to make a choice. So if a user doesn't want to be tracked, they are very free and very open, and we integrate this also into our solution to just pay a subscription fee, and then they will not going to be tracked. So there's no way to force a user that don't want to be tracked to be tracked. That's fully okay for those 1, 2, 3, maybe 8% of the users that really are very have very strong opinion about it. But also, it's important to withhold the access to a website if a user does not want to do it. And let's face it, within every browser, you can disable JavaScript. So there are already ways for a user who is tech savvy to avoid all of seeing the ads. So there are already a lot of options within the browser that exist. So that's why I'm not really entirely sure why all this ad blocking issue really comes along. And maybe because it's fully mainstream, it's easy. Everybody tells the other one it's faster, it's better. That's why everybody does it. But it's not due to only privacy reasons. Next slide, please. So what is very important in our approach is that the users should have the chance to change their settings. We want to ask the user, okay, what do you want to see? Do you want to see traditional ads, premium ads, or if you don't want to see any ads, you don't want to be tracked, just fully okay, just pay 1, 2, 3 euro, whatever, or for the entire market, 10 euro, whatever the market is going to decide, and then to not see an ad. And this is exactly why we believe that a solution that is more user-centric is better, not only for the publishing houses, but also for the user by themselves. And it's very important to communicate this option and also to the user and allow them to change their settings. So maybe they would allow advertising on a very branded, very wonderful website like BBC, for example. But if they visit another site that they don't trust, maybe they would want to disallow the specific ad. And This is very important to make it so easy for a user to change the settings and not to really keep the default settings that are placed somewhere where they cannot enter. So to have an, like we name it global ad preference, a preference that makes it easy for a user to adopt the ad consumption based on their behavior. This is a very essential piece of our model, of our approach. And then, for sure, we incentivize our publisher to also offer options, packages, products that to users that don't want to be tracked. So yes, it's an essential piece of our solution. And if a user don't want to be tracked, that's fully okay. That's we don't want to interfere. We don't want to have a situation where we deliver impressions to an ad to a user that does not want to be tracked. Next slide, please. So we believe that especially for premium sales houses and premium websites, to recover ads that are privacy conscious is the way to go. So privacy conscious means, like in 15, 20 years ago, some of the ads were hard-coded on the website. There were not so many tracking codes inside. Going back to the thinking about how to reach those 90% of the users that are not privacy, they don't have a huge privacy concern, but still deliver an advertising experience to them so that they can avoid paying a subscription. And what we hear from our publishing, from our publisher, from our clients, a lot of users accept an ad if they are able to avoid subscription fees. And let's assume the ads are better, the ads are not tracked or not tracked a lot. We assume that this is a way, this is a compromise that fits both into the privacy concerns, but also into the monetizing necessities of a publishing house. And for sure, it's always important to get an opt-in to communicate to the user as a publisher why are you using that. But it's also very important to establish the knowledge of ads as a currency and to read the content. Next, please. So that's our path, how we try to combine, how we're going to combine privacy and advertising. So the publisher need to get back to the control over the compensation. How they do this is to restrict their access to the content. And the next step is then to offer choices to consumers to select the way they want to compensate for reading the content. Might it be advertising, it might be subscription, might be something in between. And for sure, to answer the privacy concerns with a solution and a product that does not track users. And the last step is then to enable consumers to easily change their ad preferences so that not the default setting of an ad blocker or not the default setting of our solution is the one that is that's going to last for the next 1 or 2 years, but that they can change it in a way and adopt it to their consumption. Thanks so much. I see a lot of enthusiasm in your faces.
Okay, a couple of questions, as you might have probably expected. You talk a lot about default settings. Now, obviously, the ultimate default settings are the default settings in the web browser. Who manufactures the web browsers? Microsoft, Google, Mozilla, who are funded by Yahoo and previously funded by Google. The default settings, with the exception of Safari, which has third-party cookies bought by default, but was circumvented by Google in the Vidal Hall versus Google case. So the default settings in the vast majority of web browsers, certainly the most popular web browsers, are controlled by parties who have a vested interest in allowing the use of tracking and advertising. Google, Microsoft, and Mozilla. Yeah? All these three companies who make the three biggest and most popular web browsers in the world control the default settings. And the default settings in all three browsers are anti-privacy. Okay? Somebody who installs a plugin or an extension, such as AdBlock Plus, or any other ad blocker out there, have made an explicit choice to change those default settings. And certainly if they have the nuance to be able to make the choice to install the technology in the first place, they have the nuance to then look at the settings of that technology. And I've seen, for example, the AdBlock Plus installation page. It's quite clear what the settings are when you install it, and you're able to change them there and then at the installation level. But you also say yourself that you're controlling default settings with your technology, or changing who controls the default settings.
The user should be enabled to easily change the settings instead of, right now in the browser, it's very difficult to change the settings, even in the ad blocker. It's not so easy to change it. So what we need to have is a solution. Might be somewhere. It's not that our solution is the best solution for everything, but I would be very happy to have an ad blocker that it allows me as a user to adopt it easily, to change them based on my behavior.
But do you genuinely believe that the amount of time it's going to take every consumer to change the settings for every single web page they visit is a viable solution? I read some research by Laurie Craner from Stanford University a couple of years ago, and she researched the amount of time and the cost of that time it would take to read the privacy policies of the top 50 websites for every US consumer. And the cost was somewhere in the region of $500 billion in the time it would take to read those privacy policies.
Isn't that the same as asking everyone to accept cookies on every single website they go to? Isn't that the rule we had in Europe?
No, the problem isn't...
and then you complain that you make it easy for the consumers to use.
No, not at all.
I think that you know, with, I mean, it's respect, quite
Tom,
clear that your
respect,
that
Tom,
your view
Jack,
is...
Would you let me finish, please?
Well, actually, every time I speak, you want to finish instead. So tell
well,
you what...
Because I think it's a little bit rude to interrupt somebody when they're speaking, that's why. The situation isn't that people shouldn't be allowed to accept cookies. I have no problem with people being allowed to accept cookies. The problem is that they shouldn't have to watch over their shoulder every single web page that they go to in order to make sure that they're not being tracked. If the industry were behaving ethically in the first place, we wouldn't have this problem. And with regards to the type of advertising, contextual advertising, this advertising you're referring to as being 15, 20 years ago, still exists and is responsible for the development and the funding of the internet as we know it. Almost entirely. Behavioural advertising revenues are incredibly low compared to the still contextual advertising which dominates the web and is responsible for funding these technologies that we now have. The problem isn't the fact that there's advertising. The problem is the fact that there's tracking and behavioural profiling, which is now becoming commonplace for this new type of advertising, this behavioural advertising. That's what is offensive. Also, you state that there's like 2 to 8% of people are concerned with advertising. It simply isn't true. There's multiple, and I mean multiple over the past 10 years, academic studies by very respected universities across the world that show those figures to be in excess of 60% and as high as 90% of people who are concerned about the privacy issues related to online advertising. The advertising industry themselves have released reports that state that the trust in online advertising is low.
You're supporting for my point. I like
so
that.
To say 2 to 8% of people are worried about advertising simply isn't true. There's
well,
a huge
what,
concern
what
over
we can
50%.
Say, well, what we measure is if a user with an ad blocker also uses the enables the privacy list.
But you're measuring only people who use an ad blocker.
And I thought you were just referring to my ad blocker, yes. Which the actual rate of pickup for easy privacy, the choice to block tracking, if you'd like to do that, is a little higher than that. So you're discounting, if I understand correctly, all of the other ad blockers who have privacy settings, not to mention other sorts of privacy tools like Privacy Badger that the EFF offers. That's quite a few people.
Well, we can. It's a very, very economical question. We can argue if it's 10, 12, 15, 18. It's for me, it's not important. We will offer in any case a product to the user. If a user does not want to be tracked, we are happy to do so. We are happy to offer via our solution a product that does that. That's not the point. The point is that if it's 75, 65, whatever percent it is of the user, they would accept advertising. If it's not fully tracked, if it's not tracked for however this is going to look like, premium advertising, this is a wonderful, and you go to a website and you see a nice ad. They don't have a huge concern around that. So directly sold campaigns, that's what we focus on. This is not the concern, a lot of concern of the user.
I can only agree. I can offer up the statistics about how many people have opted out on our website, but I better not because, I can only say what I'm allowed to say.
So the issue is really, if you go down the funnel of the advertising industry, directly sold very often is not a lot of concern of privacy concern by user. If it's more like exchange-based cookie syncing, you have a lot of ad technologies behind it. And for sure, it's a mess sometimes. If you go to a website having one of the technologies that can show that there are 100 tracking pixels going along, that's too much. And the advertising industry, they're on their way to learning that. But it's not that the advertising in itself is wrong, and we still have a lot of advertising that can deliver a lot of revenue to publishing houses without bringing them into a real financial crisis. So that's exactly what we try to do, to consider all the privacy concerns. We're happy if it's 15, 20%, but still generate revenue with the advertising that are accepted by the user.
Sure. Could you put your microphone on?
Hello?
Yep. Can you please say who you are?
Sorry, Henry Borgman. I'm from the Netherlands Piratenpartij. I think what you are telling us is that there are possibilities for the industry. Let's say the gentleman from the BBC, for the industry, that they are not tracking, but they are tracking. And that's the point. They are using the technology. You started with it. You are using the technology that is available today and tomorrow. And they will do it, and they will optimize, let's say, the tracking issues and the tracking stuff. And that's the problem. And in my opinion, your solution is not really a solution for that. That's one issue. Another issue is, who's your customer? The customer is the content delivering company. Not us, not the customers.
So to answer your first question, if a user decides not to be tracked by whichever solution it is, then for sure there's an offering. If he still wants to read the content, they can read the content without being tracked. That's fully okay. We don't need to interfere with that. So if a user does not want to be tracked, we accept that. But if a user says, well, if I need to decide either to pay a subscription fee, or I will accept some ads, maybe with limited tracking, whatever, we need to be very transparent in that. And the user decides not to pay €3, but to say, well, I accept some of the ads, but then I don't need to pay. That should be also in the decision of a user. We are asking the user how he wants to decide.
Yeah, and to answer for the BBC, the user can download an ad blocker. Clearly, Alex doesn't have one because he saw an advert on the BBC's website. The user can decide not to have any tracking and still see the advertisement. And quite a lot of users don't believe that tracking technology is a bad thing. There's an assumption in this room that it is a bad thing, but some people prefer to see advertisements which are actually targeted towards them rather than seeing advertisements which are not targeted towards them. And that is also an acceptable option. So there are three options. You don't see any ads. You see ads with no tracking cookies on them, or you see ads with tracking.
Just out of curiosity to the BBC, what do you think of SourcePoint's solution from what you heard? Like, does it sound favorable or not to you?
Well, we're not interested at this moment in trying to have a subscription model.
No. I don't think they just offer a subscription. That wasn't one of the options. But generally speaking, what he described here, the product, would you see it as a favorable solution as you being a publisher?
You're doing my job. You're selling SourcePoint. It's good. I like it.
Well, I wonder whether technology is actually the solution here at all.
Huh? The BBC is doing geo-blocking, meaning that they are tracking people. So you just made a blatant lie in front of all of us.
How do you mean? We have to geo-block the UK, yes. Yeah, the trouble is it's almost impossible to deliver content without some identification of the web. Yeah, so, I mean, but do I know who you are? If I know what country you're coming from, have I any idea who you are? I don't think I'm tracking you. I just know that you've come from a PC that happens to be outside of the UK. And by the way, if we can't identify which country it's come from, we block it because we don't know where it's come from, so it might be inside the UK. So I mean, if you think that the use of cookies, and which are the only ones we've got in our head around, I didn't understand the rest of it, is actually inherently evil, then we wouldn't be able to operate our service without some use of cookies. Because, yes, of course we've got a barrier for those people. So it's not a blatant lie. It's just a system. It's not to track you, I have to know something about you. If you are Belgium, then actually, yes, I am tracking you. But if you're not, then I'm not.
Yeah, if you could, and fair question, but if you can get back to mine for a moment. So you saw a pitch for a product. Now, would you recommend it to your tech team to evaluate? You know, does it sound like something you worthwhile evaluating?
Well, it depends on the commercial model, doesn't it?
I'm just talking about the feature set.
It depends on the commercial model. You judge things on will it actually improve the overall service?
Okay.
Will it actually make the site run faster or slower, which is good or bad for consumers? Will you actually make or lose money doing that?
Right.
And we haven't evaluated it. Well, is it actually functional on a global scale, on multiple CDNs around the world, on a complex website across with many different operating systems, managed content systems? So there are a whole lot of things you'd think about before.
Fair enough.
We're quite a complicated business to answer that question.
Fair enough. So let me do you a favor. Okay. So
I've got a funny feeling this might be your sales pitch.
I'm sorry?
I think this might be your sales pitch coming now.
No, it's not my sales pitch. No, not at all. Just trying to clarify. So the business of SourcePoint, what you heard was not the business of SourcePoint. Okay, let's be very clear about this. The business of SourcePoint is subterfuge. Okay, they make money from obfuscating the ad within a CMS system, a content management system. So it makes it nearly impossible, not for all, but far more difficult to block an ad. They obfuscate it. That is the business of SourcePoint. Now, here's where the favor comes into you, okay? Generally speaking, one would not choose to work with any type of vendor, I would assume, okay? Not every business, but I'm assuming the BBC is on the up and up. Here's the thing. Google the management team names of SourcePoint. Go to LinkedIn, go to Google, then Google the companies they work for and count the number of times ad fraud malware comes up, okay? What essentially, and here's the favor, you would be bringing in a vendor managed, operated, and owned by digital criminals. And you do not have the ability to know that otherwise. So you would be putting a system which you believe is safe by people that you believe are legitimate, but in fact have a very clear record. A very clear record, except when it comes to ad tech, it doesn't count. That's how this company makes money. They are extremely smart people that have made careers out of abusing consumers. Google it. It's very simple. Ad fraud, malware, toolbars. Look at the number of times those come up. This is the type of stuff that publishers can choose to use. Not smart publishers, paranoid publishers, but some would choose to do it. I would recommend to you, the BBC, as a personal favor on being on this panel, you not. But completely up to you, though.
It's really interesting. I heard about that, about being personal on a panel about throwing these digital grimaces on us. Yeah, he's doing this on every panel, so if you get distracted by that, just...
It's not a distraction.
Just watch all the other panels.
It's your career. Absolutely, because the management team has not changed. Google it. Ad fraud, toolbar monetization, malware. Simple as that.
Okay, let's just take a quick step back.
Wonderful.
We're going to have coffee and tea in a couple of minutes, but before we do, I just want to raise a quick point on something that Tom mentioned. Tom said that the vast majority of users, when asked, like to see relevant ads. And this is something that I've heard repeated many, many times over the past 10 years.
I don't think I use those words precisely.
Effectively.
I said I can give you a percentage as to how many people have opted out of being targeted.
Well, no, just...
And there are lots of consumers who like to see irrelevant advertisements.
Just after that, you said that, users like to see relevant advertisements. Okay, so maybe I didn't get the word in exact, but the context was effectively the same.
In your opinion?
We'll have to accept my opinion, since I'm the one that's making the point. So this is something that I've heard from the advertising industry for a very long, long time, and bearing in mind I've been involved at a core level in the development of legislation across Europe with regards to advertising and privacy. So I've been involved and sat across the table from the advertising industry many, many, many times, including the IAB many, many, many times. And they always come up with this argument that people like to see relevant ads. What they fail to point out is the fact that, yes, people like to see relevant ads until they realize that in order to see those relevant ads, every single thing they do online is tracked. The second they realize this, the second this is pointed out to them, and you will never see this mentioned in any survey by the advertising industry, however, it has been done academically by universities across the world, the second they find out that the reason they're seeing these relevant ads is because every single thing they do online is tracked and monitored and profiled, they're absolutely horrified. And I've spoken to thousands of people over the last 10 years on this issue, and I've seen dozens of studies, academic, independent studies on this issue, and the story is always the same. So let's keep that in mind. It's very easy to say that people like relevant advertising, but you have to put it into context. When they realise that why they're seeing that relevant advertising, they're not happy at all. So we'll leave it there for now, and then we'll go on to...
One point, Alexander, I can fully support you. So that's why we focus on the direct assault campaigns that are website-centric and not behaviour-centric. So we really want to recover first the private, the premium ads that are really want to be booked on the specific website, which are not behavioural targeting, which are not user-centric, but just website-centric, and which is 70% of the revenue of a publisher. So you're talking about the 30% that is cookie-based. I'm not talking about that. We are not going to recover this. We are recovering. We are giving the user the choice not to to pay a subscription fee, but showing them premium ads that are directed to a specific website.
Okay. Well, we're out of time now for this first part of the session. So we'll have our tea and coffee, and then we're back in 15, 20 minutes. Tea and coffee is at the back of the hall there. And we'll carry on the discussion with a couple more presentations, and then we'll open up the floor for a general debate. Thank you very much.
Thank you. seen sort of a small...
My thanks to the catering service for the tea and coffee. I hope you all enjoyed. So we had an interesting, albeit sometimes heated, discussion in the first half of the session. I don't think that's a bad thing. I think it's important that people should feel free to speak their minds. So we're going to have presentations now from IO, Ben from Ben Williams, the guy who works at IO, who are responsible for AdBlock Plus, and then we'll listen to Roy talking about Shine. So would you like to take over for us, please, Ben?
Yeah, thank you, Alex. So, I wanted to tell you all maybe to come a little closer. We may be barking quite a bit, but none of us really bite, I promise. No, I'm serious. You can come in if you like. All right. Never mind. I'm the guy from AdBlock Plus, and what I'm here to talk about today is basically how AdBlock Plus has changed from a tool that started out blocking everything to a tool that blocks some things based upon user feedback and lots of other things. I'm also here to tell you about what I think about ad blocking. There have already been a lot of false things said about ad blocking on this stage, so I'm here to partially, at least as much as I can, reverse that. Because ad blocking, if you see it in the correct way, is about innovation. It's about users standing up for their rights to an industry that was never going to listen to them. And finally, now, because, well, we just passed the 500 million downloads mark, and there are lots of other ad blockers out there, including Roy's, and because of all of that, they're finally starting to take note. They're finally potentially starting to change the way that they've done business. So with that, I just want to tell you a quick history of AdBlock Plus. I'll try to go quickly today through the whole thing. Could you do the next slide, please? So AdBlock Plus, we are an open source project. We started in 2006. It was the original ad blocking code that our founder, Vladimir Palant, rewrote in 2006. If you're counting, we just turned 10. So that's kind of cool. Vladimir basically developed AdBlock Plus as an open source project that was a hobby. It was nothing more than that. He did something else during the day, and at night he developed AdBlock Plus. When he developed AdBlock Plus, he did it because of an open source community that makes what are called filter lists. Filter lists are simply ways to block things online. Essentially, you take a certain thing that you don't want to see online and you add it to a list based upon category, a category like an ad or like a tracker. And you allow people through an ad blocker, like ours or like other people's, to subscribe to a filter list. Vladimir did this for quite a long time, and he decided that he should change the way he did things because he was scared that he was endangering the free internet. And that's why our ad blocker, and now other ad blockers as well, are trying to be more nimble tools in their development. Could you, next slide, please? Going back a little bit, all ad blocking is based upon open source filter lists. That is to say, we don't choose what gets blocked. These filter lists go by many names, including Easy List, that's the most popular one, and they are maintained by a group of moderators, each one, and they also are contributed to by sometimes up to 200 different people, at least for the AdBlock Plus contributors, as well as lots of other people out there, as well as you, if you'd like to contribute to a filter list. Then what happens is that the ad blocker, there are a couple up there, or back there, as it were, lets the user manage those lists. The ad blocker also lets the user write their own filters if they choose to. So this is basically what an ad blocker does, is it allows you to have complete control over your online experience. Next slide, please. Okay, so basically users have the power. I kind of thought this slide may fall flat in this room. I'm an American. This is He-Man. It was really popular when I was a kid.
He-Man was everywhere.
Really? Oh, awesome. So everybody should get this then. So He-Man, when he became He-Man, he would grab his sword and he would say, "I have the power." So I think that becoming He-Man is sort of like what it's like when you use your first ad blocker. Because an ad blocker has become a very, very skillful way of giving users the control of their online experience. It's become not just an ad blocker, but more of a web customizer. Because you, and every one of you, can take an ad blocker and do whatever it is you want to do with that, including blocking tracking, blocking malware, blocking ads, blocking anything you want, especially if you know how to write filters yourself. So, next slide, please. But taking a step back, we've had this already a few times, but you know, we've been doing this for 10 years, so we ought to know. We've got a lot of user feedback under our belts. We have done several surveys, lots of studies. Other people have done surveys as well. My colleague over there at SourcePoint, he has done a couple of surveys himself. And what they found is it's basically four reasons why people want to block ads. Annoyance, intrusiveness. When something pops into your feed, when something pops over your screen, it's annoying. Let's just call it what it is. And people don't want to have that when they go to experience a website, which, let us not forget, is the reason that people go to the website, not for the ads, but for the content. The second reason is privacy. Privacy is just one way that people have told us that they, or one reason that people have told us that they want to use an ad blocker. Ad blockers let you control your privacy online. The next reason is security. We mentioned malvertising. For those of you who don't know, that's an ad that's been infected by malware. The problem is that most ads are served over huge ad servers, and the people who control those ad servers can't or won't control who gets through on their network. So sometimes even very well-meaning ad networks accidentally serve malware. To protect yourself against that, you can install an ad blocker. Ad blockers block the ads that serve the malware. And so many people have said, as malvertising increases, I think it went up by threefold last year, that security is a big reason why they install ad blockers. The final reason there is more for mobile, but as more people are able to block ads on their mobile device, data and page load speeds come into it. Quite simply, you have to download an ad, so that costs you time and that costs you money. Next slide, please. So you're left with a choice. Either accept the ads that are on the site and essentially be annoyed. You can not visit the site, you can block the ads, or you can pay for content. And next slide. Well, 200 million internet users have chosen option 3, and I think that number has probably increased. This is a third-party study that was done, and that was done for 2014. I think the next time that it comes out, that number will only have grown. This is the reality that we all have to deal with. This is the genie that's now outside and not going to jump back in the bottle. And it's a right that, in all fairness to my colleague at SourcePoint, I think users have to determine. I don't think publishers have the right to reinsert ads into a user's experience that the user has expressly said they would like to block. If they do have that ad, I don't think it's a very good idea. So, next slide. Ah, a better way. Could there be a better way? Well, as I say before, our founder, Vladimir Palant, he was having misgivings about blocking all the ads because he thought he was killing the free internet. So he decided to explore a number of solutions. One of the solutions that he explored was to let users basically give money to sites in a way by viewing the ads on them by whitelisting them. And the idea was if you visit a site, say 20, 25 times, we would give you a little pop-up that would say, hey, you might want to consider contributing some money to this site by whitelisting them. Well, our users, God love them, they viewed it as a pop-up ad. And so they were very annoyed with the solution. They asked us to disallow it, so we did. Anyway, Vladimir, he tried several different solutions, and what he eventually came to is that users aren't expressly against all ads. There may be ads out there that some users would accept, even AdBlock Plus users. So next slide, please. So we asked them, and over three-quarters of our users said, sure, we'd be fine with ads as long as they didn't annoy us, as long as they didn't intrude upon our experience. So we got to thinking, or at that point I should say Vladimir got to thinking, it was one guy, what could be criteria for ads that even an ad blocker would accept? So a lot of our acceptable ads criteria and program was mischaracterized before, so let me set the record straight. He went to our users, and he asked that. And then he had several discussions with our users over several forum posts about what could a better ad be. Because let's face it, at that time, if he would have lost his users, they could have gone to one of the other 199 free ad blockers out there and decided to block ads through them. Next slide, please. So with our users, we developed these criteria. This is a simplification of those criteria, but essentially they have to do with placement, with distinction, and with size. Ads should not take up too much size. They should be distinguished clearly from the other criteria. That means that they should be labeled clearly as an advertisement and differentiated from the editorial content. And they should not be placed smack dab in the middle of two paragraphs. Things like this, our users told us, we find annoying. So we set up a system that under which if advertisers or publishers come to us with acceptable ads that meet these criteria, we will vet those ads. We will make those ads that they'd like to whitelist available for our forum to debate and discuss, and we will whitelist those ads. Now, the question of payment came up before, so I'd like to just go ahead and set the record straight on that as well. In acceptable ads, the top 10% of the companies on our whitelist pay a service fee, a licensing fee to us. This allows us to stay afloat. Otherwise, Vladimir would have never been able to hire anyone to help him deal with the 500 million downloads he was getting. The beautiful thing is the criteria are the same no matter if you pay or if you don't pay. And it also makes it free for the other 90%. So we see that as a pretty fair deal. Next slide, please. Now, I apologize because you can't see this, but we constantly test to see is that still something that our users accept. This is a study that, or this is part of a study that we did with the survey firm Ipsos, where we asked people to look at actual ads, actual type of ads, and say how disruptive they felt that ad to be. And so it's basically exactly what you would expect. They are more disrupted by the bigger side on my left, I guess yours too, and they are less. They find the ads on the right side less disruptive. The ads on the left side are wraparound banners, things that wrap around content. They're automatically playing animations, pop-up ads. No big surprise, right? the things that people weren't as annoyed by were search ads. They were static ads. They were conservative banner ads, even with images in them, that didn't intrude upon their experience. So we have been improving the criteria as we've gone along.
Okay.
I've been given the time thing, so could you? Okay, and this is just to say that I'm glad people brought up the default thing. This is our first run page. When you install AdBlock Plus, that's what you see. And that's where you see that with one click, you can opt out of the acceptable ads. So right there when you install, you can click out of it. Right below that, you can add other lists, things that block tracking and allow you to control your privacy. So that's all when you install the program. We make that as clear as possible. Next slide, please. But how can we improve this? Well, this is our idea to create a firewall between ourselves, AdBlock Plus, and the criteria for acceptable ads. This is a new committee that we'd like to form. It will be independent, and this committee will take over control of the criteria for acceptable ads. So we understand that what we do is controversial. We understand that a lot of people don't really like us very much. And we heard a lot of criticism about acceptable ads. So we decided, okay, how can we make acceptable ads better by making it scalable and making it more transparent? This accomplishes both, because this new committee will completely take over control of what the criteria are. Next slide, please. Wow. August. So you can't see this. So let's just go on to the next one. We're low on time. The goal of the board, the committee, is to take control of the acceptable ads initiative. The concrete objectives, these will probably always stay the same, are to protect user experience, promote non-intrusive formats, and still to provide meaningful monetization opportunities for publishers and for advertisers. Next slide, please. So you may ask, well, who's going to be on it? Well, we don't know exactly yet, because we're still holding listening sessions with people from the industry. In fact, on February 2nd, next week in London, we are holding what we're calling Camp David Europe, a discussion with advertisers and publishers about how we should form this board. We had one called Camp David New York in September, in which we did the same thing. But these are the tentative members we could imagine in this committee. So you see advertisers, publishers, ad tech, that's kind of one side. On the other side, you see nonprofits and member organizations, journalists and content creators, and user agent representatives. Next slide, please. Oh, I'm done. So, I'll wrap things up here, but I want to really stress the point that ad blocking is a statement of consumer dissatisfaction, and it's up to all of us how we go forward. I agree with some of the sentiment that's been expressed up here that we are in a transitionary period right now. I really think that we are. We're trying to figure things out just like the music industry did. We at AdBlock Plus, we started using acceptable ads a while back, and we've chiseled away at that and made it better in the meantime. We think that this acceptable ads committee can take it to another level. But the bigger idea is that ad blocking perhaps started in the wrong way. It started by blocking everything, and then it has dialed back and become less of a complete ad blocker in the meantime to a very specific ad blocker. And so with that, I'll leave the rest of my time.
Thank you, Ben. There's a lot of things I want to say, but I'm aware that we're running short on time, so I will leave it until after we've heard from Roy. Roy, would you like to continue with your presentation?
Sure. So I'll try to be fairly quick so we can jump more into conversation, if that's okay. So real briefly, let me describe Shine for you in under 5 minutes. As I mentioned earlier, Shine was founded as an anti-malware company. The core expertise of the company is cybersecurity and white hat hacking. The guys had an idea to reinvent the antivirus. They went off, developed some algorithms. Lo and behold, very, very effective stuff. You know, probably the most modern technologies in terms of malware one could find. As we were starting to deploy our technology sort of via a kind of a standard Android app, we were asked to look at some activity on a telco, on a wireless carrier, and what we discovered really changed the fate of the company. What we noticed was that a lot fewer people were impacted by malware. However, and that is at least in comparison to what we discovered was, which is the magnitude of the impact that ad tech was having on consumers around the world. And that was a really interesting insight for us. And then we dove in deeper, and what we realized was, and it was more of a realization rather than an insight in the sense that we never actually looked at the problem in such a way, was that really the smartest people in Silicon Valley are developing ad tech, right? Or working for Uber. Those are the two options you have right now. But essentially, these are extremely smart people that could be working for military intelligence agencies, but instead are working in the private sector for a bunch of money, developing technologies that are called tracking and targeting and not particularly nice activities. So when we realized that, we decided that we could retool the technologies that we developed, really cutting edge stuff, really smart stuff, to analyze, determine, and then block advertising should a consumer want it. And that led or changed the mission of the company to one that's fairly simple. We believe that consumers deserve the right to block ads. We believe that is up to the consumer. And if a consumer does not want to see ads, that's their choice. And if there are consequences, so be it. That's perfectly fine. That's legitimate on behalf of the publisher. But that's a very kind of simple statement that that most of the ad tech industry doesn't agree with. There are actually very progressive voices in the ad tech industry, less public ones, but ones that are speaking to us, that understand that ad blocking is not going to go away, and understand that there needs to be a fundamental rethinking of how online advertising works. So a lot of stuff that you see here, including SourcePoint, is a lot of kind of, I want to say, not even Band-Aid solutions. They're trying to kind of, you know, round a corner. But those are not really, you know, long-term solutions to the problem that we're trying to solve, which is mass consumer abuse by advertising technologies, period. Okay, there is no advertising technology that does not abuse a consumer. We can get into debate on the level of abuse, but that's shades of gray. It's abuse, okay, period. Shine is working, unlike IO, for example, and it's important not to look at ad blockers in a single uniform way because we don't work in the same way technologically and also from a business perspective. People tend to criticize ad blockers based on IO's business model because they're maybe the more well-known one, but that's actually factually incorrect. So let me describe how we work. We work with carriers. And the reason we chose to work with carriers rather than directly with the consumer in terms of deploying or distributing a consumer app is for two very simple, very impactful reasons. Number one, you have two companies that control the mobile OSs, Apple and Google. Unless they provide the necessary depth to provide an ad-blocking product that is on par with desktops, you're going to have severe problems providing that type of experience. So unless they provide you depth, you can't do it. That's problem number one. Let's assume that by, you know, ability of technological expertise, you were able to figure out a way to work within the OS and the kernel to provide a fairly effective ad blocking solution. Then you would be impacted by the distribution channels. Well, again, same two companies happen to control these distribution channels, the App Store and Google Play. Until the summer, Apple did not have, did not allow such products or such apps to be in the App Store. Google is very problematic still in that sense. They change terms of service. They pull stuff out. So the reality is that if you were a company and you set out to bring an effective ad blocking product to market, going through as an app is not going to work for you. So we looked at that and said, okay, well, you know, we still think we want to do this. What's the best way then that's not directly to the consumer? And we figured that the best way to do it then is to work with the carriers. So what we do is we provide carriers with technology that they integrate on their back end in their data centers that removes the ads before they hit the device. So unlike an iOS app that you may have installed that removes the ad once it's sort of basically here, we make it disappear way in a data center, right? So there's no usage of data, a bunch of stuff is irrelevant, and it's more effective. More effective in the sense that we make ads disappear within apps and on mobile browsers, both within iOS and Android. And the experience is, well, fantastic, really. And that's also a problem for AdTech because the alternative is not. We currently have about 60 carriers in our funnel of various degrees. If anybody thinks this is not a Western economy type of service, you're wrong. A number of European carriers have relations with us, American ones. This is a global phenomenon, meaning somebody in the Philippines is suffering from AdTech just as much as somebody here in Brussels, as much as somebody in Cincinnati, okay? So this is a global problem. We believe there needs to be a fundamental recalibration, a rethinking, a restructuring of how AdTech works and respects consumers. And that's what we essentially do. And we're a fairly vocal player in the space, I want to say. I think everybody here can agree. So that's enough about China. And I think in order to kind of maybe jump into the conversation, let me just kind of put things into perspective for you, okay? And then throw it off to a question and then kind of a discussion. So when we talk about ad blocking, you have to understand there's perspectives that you may have not considered. Right? So let me give you an example. Gentleman from the BBC, let me ask you a quick question. Let's say there was a story that broke in the US that there was $1 billion fraud scandal within the American banking system. Okay? That's the premise. Do you think it would be a leading news item across your broadcasting formats? Yes or no? Likely. Not likely.
It depends what other news is going on in the day, but probably.
But probably, agree top five.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree. Here's the thing. In the U.S. alone, in 2015, there was approximately $7.2 billion worth of ad fraud. Not in the news. Because, it's ad tech, so, not a big deal. Well, it is a big deal. Number one, it's a big deal, period, within the industry. Secondly, why are consumers thrust into this form of extraordinary fraud? Does a consumer have a choice or deserve the choice to remove him or herself from this type of activity? Shine believes the answer is yes. It might not be convenient for the publishing industry, but it is a reality. There are a lot of perspectives here that go beyond data usage and tracking. It's a story about abuse, and we're bringing choice to consumers, and we can open it up.
So my question would be, what is the business model behind it? Who's going to pay you then, like the user? Or is the telco going to pay you and then they decide? If you try to be user-centric, how is this going to look like? It's a very interesting question.
The business model is completely irrelevant to the issue. This is consumer abuse. Either you agree it's abusive or not. And then if you agree it's abusive, does the consumer deserve choice in stopping it? It's as simple as that. Don't get into how we make money. We're not philanthropists. I assure you, we promised our investors multifold back. We're good on that respect.
So I don't think this publisher would disagree at all that the consumer's got a right to block ads. I think I said that in my own presentation. And indeed, when the story is slightly more exciting than financial frauds, the journalist has the ability to stop the advertising appearing. So we can check a box before the story is published and there will be no ad running against that story. So we're doing that all the time anyhow. And I agree with you, it's not necessarily about the business model. But the reality is that it is about whether the consumer gets the choice through your model. I think you go too far when you say that ad tech is abuse. And it seems to be this underlying thing that somehow or other targeting is a bad idea, and somehow or other advertising is a bad idea. Loads of benefits have come from the world of advertising. There is enough academic research behind that.
Would you like me to define abusive? Well, I'm happy to.
Well, I mean, I'm sure you're going to.
Well, I mean, it's not. I mean, we're not talking about subtleties. We're talking about technologies that track, target, steal data, and impair user experience. Fairly abusive in my head. I mean, I don't know about you. I mean, what does something need to do to be abusive?
I don't know. I guess that if you pick yourself up a store card in order to get special offers, then your data is tracked and then used to target you with messages about different foods and things. That's not online advertising. That's just the way in which the marketing business has operated for years and years. I think that mail that comes through your letterbox in the 1980s was also against the list.
Different situation altogether. Our data has shown that anywhere between 5 and 50% of a consumer's data plan is used by ad tech. Should a consumer subsidize ad tech? Is that not stealing from a consumer's...
You're throwing statistics. I don't know about any of that. All I know
I'm speaking a fact that we discovered. Assume we have integrity of that sort. If that was the case, if 50% of your, if you have kids, of your kids' data plans, or your wife's, or your family's, was taken away by a third party, unbeknownst to you or them, do you believe that is not abusive? It's a simple question. There are no shades of gray in this.
Well, not in your mind, no.
I would say not in hundreds of millions of people's minds.
Let me just jump in for a second. Certainly it is an issue. People have restricted data plans where they're limited to the amount of data that they can use and they have to pay for excess data. So there is an argument that could be classed as abusive. I'm going to quickly jump in before we open the floor. There's a number of issues that I wanted to quickly cover. Roy, we've discussed this before in the past. Anybody who knows me reasonably well knows that I cut my teeth on deep packet inspection and the use of such technologies by a company called Form in the UK, who were trying to intercept all internet users' communications for the purpose of behavioural profiling, which is why I moved into this sphere in the first place. Shine's technology at the network level is DPI-based, correct?
Mm-hmm. Indeed.
This is problematic from my perspective. It rings alarm bells. It also has some regulatory hurdles to overcome. In Europe, deep packet inspection, the inception of communications requires consent from all parties in that communication. I find it highly unlikely that the publisher and the advertising providers are going to provide their consent for the inception of the communication for your technology. That's a hurdle you're going to have to overcome here in Europe. I also have other concerns with the use of deep packet inspection in any relationship with a mobile telecoms operator or a telecoms operator in general. It's the thin end of a wedge. There have been moves in this direction before, and they weren't good, and they were very detrimental to the customers of those telecoms providers, British Telecom in the UK being the primary. My concern is once you start to install deep packet inspection for commercial purposes, it becomes too tempting to use it for other purposes in that same commercial field. So will these partners or these telecoms partners that you're working with be able to resist the temptation to monetize that technology in other ways? That's a big concern.
So good. So fantastic questions. So this is a very prickly subject, quite obviously, and unfortunately, and I'll say why. We believe that if a consumer opts into this type of service, regulatory issues should not inhibit him or herself from being able to protect him or herself. So stuff like net neutrality and issues of that sort were not designed to inhibit protection. Unfortunately, they are being used and are murky, too murky, to make the situation fairly simple and straightforward. So yes, it is a challenge for us. However, as you can imagine, we wouldn't have dived into this deep end without a lot of legal work on our end and our carrier's end. But I think the more interesting comment is the following. How can consumers trust that power won't be abused? Well, that exactly goes into what I mentioned earlier about backgrounds, and you mentioned, well, you're taking it very personally. Yes, it is personal. We bring a certain integrity, a certain reputation, a certain character. We do not design our technologies, nor will we ever, to abuse consumers. Nobody will be able to use our technology for abusive purposes. Now, don't forget, DPI is used. It's used to accelerate video, unbeknownst to users, for their benefit. It's also used to remove problematic pornographic issues, such as pedophilia and such issues. So the question is, what is it used for and on whose behalf and on whose request? If you take for granted, and I hope you would in our respect, that we come from a positive direction, we were anti-malware, we are anti-ad tech, we are pro-consumer, we remain pro-consumer, that it will be then our responsibility to prove that our reputation should be deserved and deserves the loyalty of consumers. That's as simple as that, and that will take time, certainly. But we have a background, a fairly good background, so I think we can maintain it.
May I say
yes,
something?
Yes, yes, go ahead.
To be honest, I think you are a nice guy, and I trust you, but I don't want to have any deep package in tools installed in let's say, between the guy who's operating the website and my computer. Yeah? Because it will not end. Yeah? If you are living in Berlin, you can go to the Stasi Museum. It will not end.
But, sir, first of all, it's already happening. So I'm saying it's a reality. And I'm not saying that to make the issue kind of simplify it. But in our respect, it's a perfectly legitimate concern. And if it would be very clear to you when you will be given the opportunity to opt in to Shine that is happening. And should you feel uncomfortable with our methodology to help protect you, then sadly we would not be able to protect you.
But let's say going in with your tool, sure, is setting a think. That's it. Yeah? And so somebody else can also set in that think. I don't want that kind of tools in the connection. It's wrong, in my opinion.
Again,
it's dangerous.
Perfectly understandable, yeah? But it would be very clear to you what you're opting into, and it would then be our responsibility to maintain the promise that we made to you. And if we abuse it, then you have every right, and I implore you to stop your relationship with us.
But I know for sure that the founder of Facebook, when he started on his in his study room, mm-hmm, with Facebook, he had the most ideal things in his mind. Mm-hmm. But now he's also paid by you know who in Washington, and we all know what happened. And it's for Google the same. That's not what we need, in my opinion. So I think you have a good solution.
Again, I can only speak on our integrity and hope to maintain our reputation. It will be our responsibility to continue assuring you of that. But it's a responsibility, no question about that.
I don't think there's any question on your integrity. Obviously, we have to take you on your word of this. My problem is the third parties. I can't imagine that any telecoms operator, certainly none that I've met in the past, would allow you to run technology in their networks without them having some control over it. And how they then abuse that technology is an issue. There are other issues with regards to the risk for the telecoms providers. At the moment, under the e-commerce directive, they're classed as mere conduits because they don't control any of the data that's within those communications. If they're now seen to be filtering the data that's in those communications, that leaves them potentially liable under e-commerce directive as being protected as no longer being mere conduits. So there are some issues. Generally,
absolutely,
I'm supportive
of
ad blocking technology from a privacy perspective, but I think there's some issues that need to be ironed out with your existing technology. I don't want to dominate. We've only got about 10 minutes left, so I'm going to pass the questions out to the floor now. Would you like to start? Use your microphone, please.
Yes, with pleasure. Thank you. I would like to introduce myself. My name is Martin Rupp. I'm here for the European Magazine Media Association, and I would like to follow up on what the colleague from the Piratenpartei has just said, because we very much agree as publishers that we don't want any interference between what the website operator is sending and what the user finally is consuming without that the user has the control. And actually, and that's what Tom said several times, if the consumer doesn't want to see the ad, doesn't want to see the website, we're fine with that. We just want, and we were talking a lot about the right of the user to decide what he wants to see. Absolutely agree with that. But we hardly ever spoke today at all about the right of the freedom of expression. And the right of the freedom of expression includes that when I design my website, be I a blogger or be I a big publisher, I have the freedom not only to design the content and write what I want, be it intrusive or not, but also to design the website the way that I want it. And the consumer then decides whether he wants to see it or not. And even if the consumer finds a way to block out the advertisement within the website, it's the consumer's decision. But those are not your offers. You are not giving the decision to the consumer. You are taking the decision what the consumer and the user will finally see. And this is, on the one side, an infringement of the freedom of the expression and to the product that the publisher is delivering. The product is not only the content, the product is also the advertisement, without giving the power back to the controller. You are making your own business. You are making money with that. You can call that a licensing fee or a service fee. But you are making a business with the interference between the website operator, and I'm also talking about bloggers, not only about the big publishers, and the user who does not get the control. So that's the one thing that fundamentally disturbs the whole idea of how the web works, which is based on advertising revenue, only like that we can pay the journalistic content. The whole other, and that's the completely second thing that I wanted to address, besides the fact that the discussion is very ideologized and very one-sided when we talk about any ad tech offer is abusive. I mean, that's just so one-sided that we are getting far away from a sober discussion. The same is the comment by the moderator that people are horrified just by the thought of being tracked. We are well aware that this is definitely not the fact, even though we know that some people are, but it's definitely not a 100% correct reply. But what I actually want to say to that respect is that we do have data protection law, which is applied by data protection authorities. And also as regards the installation of malware and any other infringements of users' privacy rights, those are protected by data protection authorities, and we don't actually need ad blockers to take the role as a data protection authority and make money on that. That's the Data Protection Authority's role.
I could spend all afternoon addressing the comments you've just made, but we don't have the time.
Thank you.
With regards to Data Protection Authorities, a discussion for another meeting, I suspect, but certainly enforcement of the regulations is very lacking and is acknowledged as being very lacking. Also, circumvention of user choice, and we only have to look at case law and an example of that, such as Google versus Vito Hall in the UK.
But do we want data protection enforcement in private hands, or do we want it in governmental hands?
It's not in private hands. It's a consumer choice, as far as I'm aware. A user has to explicitly choose to install an ad blocker, as opposed to having it installed for them in their browser. So it's a user choice at the end of the day. But the things that you're talking about, I don't really have the time to address here today. I think there's a lot of meat in what you're saying and something that needs to be discussed over a longer time period, which we simply don't have the time to do today. Does anybody else have any questions? Yes?
Good afternoon. Thank you very much for your presentation. I'm Joachim Jube. I'm working for the German internet industry. Maybe a few words regarding the empowerment of the consumer. There has been, for many years now, a self-regulation regime in place covering, in fact, the European Union and other countries, the market coverage for online behavioral advertising, so started by the EDAA. The market coverage in Germany is over 90%, and it's comparable in other countries of the European Union. This is the first point. So what I want to say by this is that an ad blocker is certainly not the only way to empower the consumer, and the consumer has been empowered for many years now, to reduce any cookies by clicking one button, in fact. So, first point. Second point, just two major points referring ad blockers, especially AdBlock Plus. Thank you, Ben, for your presentation. In fact, there are two major problems. First, the representativity of the choice made by AdBlock Plus, saying that the consumer are involved, representatively involved, in choosing what ads are acceptable and what ads are not acceptable. For the time being, this body is completely obscure. So I don't accept any representativity referring this point. The second point is even worse. AdBlock Plus is, of course, a business model and not a company at the service of the consumer. AdBlock Plus is traveling around Germany, blackmailing, in fact, big companies, asking them to pay a service fee, more euphemistic. And so sorry, Ben, but this is not kind of cool. This is highly parasitical.
May I respond?
Yeah, you can.
Okay. Okay, if I had a dime for every time I've heard the big B word, blackmailing. Let's face it, though. We don't choose what's blocked in the first place. We were the ad blocker that chose to start listening to users about what they might find better, what they might find more acceptable. That's the first point. So the extortionist claims are ridiculous. There are a million people between an advertiser and a publisher. The idea that one more who would represent the user between the advertiser and the publisher might jump in is completely okay, I think. The second, I actually think the first point was a lot more damaging because, quite frankly, we involved users in every step of the process. We try to get users involved in forum debates. We put every single whitelisted ad up in our forum. Quite bluntly put, you cannot make someone be interested in the niceties of ad tech and advertising and publishing. So the idea that only a small amount of people in our forum or maybe even in some cases a very large amount of people take part in these discussions is, of course, logical. These are arcane issues, and to be quite frank, they can be sometimes very boring issues. But I wonder how we could have done it differently. If you have a better idea, I'd love to hear it. But the bottom line is, as I pointed out from the very beginning, ad blocking developed as a complete cure. Right, as an absolute thing. There is no ad zapper out there. There is no thing where you can start at the beginning and say, I don't like that ad, I don't like that ad, and you zap them and they disappear forever. That's just not the way that the technology currently works. So I feel that we've tried to involve users as much as possible. And I also feel that in the future, our committee is going to involve users even more. It's also going to divorce us from the process. And, that it's controversial, that it's not perfect, okay. But I don't think that throwing around nasty words is the right way to describe it.
Okay, thank you. But just one little point. Do you deny that you whitelist ads from companies paying what you call a service fee without any further examination?
I do deny that. We, at first, the criteria must be met. And you can look at every single whitelisted ad that we have and check it.
And my understanding is anybody can report an ad which doesn't meet the criteria. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay, next question.
Hello, Guillaume Marceau. I work in a small French ad tech company, so I'm fresh, so please pardon my English accent. I have a question on user choice, and please be sure I don't contest the representativity of AdBlock Plus. If I'm correct, it should be something like 40% of the market in Europe. There's also AdBlock, which is pretty similar. It's also 40% of the market. Both work with EasyList and PrivacyList, as you explained before. And both say privacy is very important for all of their users, but both do not enable the privacy list by default. So let's assume all of these users are very concerned with privacy, and I think it's the point of this debate. I'm not really good in math, but doesn't it mean that the vast majority of them are quite being fooled? And I know that AdBlock is the expression of the user choice, and just like an opt-out, it would be a super opt-out for all ad tech companies. And legally speaking, respecting user choice is really mandatory when it comes to the collection, the use of personal data from the user. But I was wondering if it's the same thing from a legal point of view, what the question is to access content for free.
I'm sorry, what was the last part of the question? I can respond to
the question is, user choice is mandatory when it comes to data collection and use of personal data. I don't think it's mandatory when it comes to just accessing content for free, because if we take that advertising is the natural counterpart of the content that you can access for free on the internet, that's the basis for all media. I think that no media ever survived without advertising. So if it's really the counterpart of that free access, if you just choose to put an ad blocker but don't enable the privacy list, I don't say the thing because legally speaking, we are only bound to respect the choice when it comes to privacy. That's really this point. I wanted to have maybe more precision on it. I'm not really familiar with the ad blocking question. Learned a lot today, but that's pretty blurry for me.
Okay, thanks. Let me just respond, I guess, to the first part, which is basically, I think, why is easy privacy not default, right? Well, we started out as a simple ad blocker that had basically easy list according to your language as the default list. We tried to keep it as simple as possible and do what it says out of the box. Now that has changed, of course, over the years, but make easy privacy has always been a default or a non-default choice, but you can always make it, and it's on the first run page if you choose to install it. So for us, it's like we put a product out there, and just like a car, we're going to give you the product in what we think is the best form that product can come in. If you want to customize it, you can do so endlessly.
Yeah, but we are all saying, and I think we all agree, that the main point is to put the user in the middle again, and to put him in control. He has the power. That would be a great thing, but most of the people rely on by default setting, and ad blockers have a huge responsibility when it comes to that. And I really think that it wouldn't take too much time to ask the user when they install an ad blocker, to ask them 5 minutes to define, okay, you don't like ads, why is it? Is it because of privacy? Is it because of certain type of formats? And maybe take this opportunity to raise their awareness on the whole economy of the internet. Okay, nothing is free. You have to suffer advertising. That's the counterpart.
That's a fair point. And you know, from a product perspective, you can only send out so many messages when you have a first run page. And our users, as I was mentioning before, with this one solution that Vladimir came up with, they hated it. They were annoyed by it. So we have tried to survey our users before. I think I showed the 76% acceptance rate. We have, but we do so at our peril because users sometimes find it annoying. We do, however, on that same page, allow you to subscribe to Easy Privacy. So, you know, it's a product question, but it's a good one, and perhaps we should take it into consideration.
Yeah, I'll jump in quickly, just a second. As a privacy guy, obviously, I would love to see the privacy list enabled by default. I can't argue against that. But at the same time, by even using the easy list, the normal easy list, it's blocking the connection to those third-party advertisers in the first place. So whereas it may not be as comprehensive as using both the easy list and the easy privacy list, there is still a significant increase in the privacy of users who only have the easy list installed because it's blocking those third-party adverts in the first place. So they're still having an enhanced level of privacy even by not installing the easy privacy list.
Yeah, just to kind of not to deal with the privacy issue, but listen, everybody's a product manager when it comes to ad blocking products. But what I would recommend, okay, is actually looking at the other way. You said you're from a small French ad tech company. Yeah, I couldn't, you know, that's a French accent, really?
Yeah.
Shocked. So here's a suggestion. Talk to publishers and tell them to product manage their sites better. And if you do that, you'll actually discover a far better impact upon the consumer experience and satisfaction, or rather less dissatisfaction, than asking ad blockers to product manage their own products. That's what's really missing.
Yeah, I completely agree with you, but the question is always, who has the power to define the by default settings? It's not the publishers, it's not anybody. And with by default setting of the main ad blockers, you block all ads, disregarding if they are really intrusive or not, because I don't know, you have criteria defined by your community, considering that text.
I can't really hear you. Can you get closer to the mic, please?
Excuse me?
Get closer to the mic.
Oh, sorry. your criteria is defined by your community, but you wipe all the advertising, disregarding the fact that some of the ads that could be blocked are not intrusive ads. You consider that text ads are not intrusive, but maybe a nice little picture on the right place is also responsible ads.
I can fully agree. Let me jump in. The biggest weakness of the existing ad blockers are that they decide what's good for a user or not, what a user wants to accept or not. So that's why I think what we all need is like a solution that asks the user for the preferences and then stick to the preferences. Might it be no tracking? Might it be, oh, I don't like wallpaper, but I like video ads? And this is where we need a solution that the user is really in the center of all of the advertising system. Ask him for his preferences, and then all the ad technology, if you like it or not, needs to stick to that. So this is exactly the actual weakness, and this is why we believe that this needs to change.
So I could only say that I would agree with those last comments, and that we as a publisher have tried to product manage, and I think I showed some of the things that we do, and the users can take their choice off the back of that. I think I'd like to refer you to the last couple of slides I showed when I was doing my presentation, which seems like a year ago now. And that is that to try and finish on a slightly more positive front, Alex, and I thought, as we come to the end of the time, is that the whole ad blocking discussion is actually in the round a really good thing. You know, there's good advertising and there's less good advertising in the world, and there always has been throughout whichever medium you use. And the companies you see up here, you know, they may or may not be part of the solution or the whole solution or what have you. Who knows what the future holds. But I did show one slide where there's a whole lot of innovation going on that's outside of the world of blocking. People are actually doing things to make things better for the consumer right now. And so I would say that sometimes people invent things because they can and not because they should. And if ad blocking has done anything to the industry, it's kind of corrected that balance somewhat. And it will never be perfect. It will never be perfect. But actually, we have to be really careful that we don't blow up the ad-supported internet as we go through this period of transition. And I think that's not necessarily going to happen, because a lot of innovation is going on right now, right outside of the people on this stage. And so that's what's important to me.
Two more quick questions. Gentleman at the back first.
Oh, sorry. Thanks very much. My name is Adam Gagan. I'm from the World Federation of Advertisers. So we're essentially the global brand owners. So I'm not sure if it's the right thing to own up for in this room, but we're the people paying for this whole situation. The question I had was actually to really get a sense of the direction of travel. I was trying to think what everyone on the panel has in common in terms of an objective. It's quite hard, but I think pretty much everyone is at least trying to improve the online experience one way or the other. And at least
not me, no.
You're trying to make it worse.
No. My incentive is completely different. My incentive is protecting the fundamental rights of consumers. I really don't give a damn about the online experience. It's up to publishers to incentivize users in a way that's acceptable and ethical. My concern is based on the fundamental rights of the users, and always has been.
Yeah, we would say that that's probably an improvement that the industry needs as well, to improve the situation for real people out there. So we'd see that just as a good thing. For ourselves, though, what we see globally as the people producing products around the world is that people are different. They want different things. And so my question is really, do you think that the industry, all of the different options which are on this panel and are being developed in, I'm sure, garages around the world, do you think these solutions are going to be increasingly personalized? Do you think individuals, as was mentioned, are going to increasingly say what kind of advertising they like, what kind of formats, what kind of frequencies? Or do you think, out of all of this, we're simply going to raise the bar? We're going to basically improve the general situation to a point where most normal people are then okay with the situation. Which direction do you think it's going to go in?
We'll give each person a chance to answer.
In order to personalize, you have to share some information. Yeah, and a whole lot of people won't want to do that. So if you're a publisher such as ourselves, you have a reason. Also, you want to be quite careful with personalizing when you're delivering news, because you know, how many people would actually sign up for some of the stories that we run? So if you run a news organization, I'd say there are three things you've got to do. You've got to tell people what you think they should hear, yeah, based on the fact that that's important in the world. Secondly, you should tell people what everybody else is looking at. Yeah. And then you should let them, if they want to, tune some of the messages. Yeah. And that actually is a contract backs and forwards between the consumer. And that's way outside of the advertising world, yeah. So it is our intention to improve that experience. I don't sit in the same place as Alex, because that's us as a product and trying to reach as many people as possible with our message. You could argue that advertisers want to do the same thing.
I wouldn't expect many people to sit in my place. That's why I have my job. Ben, you please.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I mean, you could mean a lot of things by personalized, right? So I think that though tracking, the big T word, gets demonized and vilified a little more than it could get vilified, there are potentially ways that where consumers are aware that could deliver more relevant and better advertising. That's absolutely a possibility. The way that it currently happens when people aren't informed, it's no wonder that they install things like ad blockers. But I don't know. I think the bigger question was what does this industry look like? What is the shakeup like? And I think we may have a parallel in the music industry of 10 years ago when everyone was running scared of piracy and all that stuff. And I think that in the future we will probably see a mixture of monetization schemes, ads being a very important one, but maybe better contextual, less intrusive ads. And then add to that, you know, complete user control. I think that's what we have to accept at the end of the day.
Thomas.
Well, finally, I can really support Ben. I think it's the user that's going to be in the center of it, and they need to decide. They need to control all of their behavior. If it's then personalized, yes, why not? If they want the ad to be personalized, but that's to empower the user to make their own decision and to give them the choice to decide. That's what we believe is going to happen.
World Federation of Advertisers. That's like the Starfleet of advertisers, it sounds like. Let me actually not answer the question and throw it back to you. So I'm not paid to think up publisher experiences or advertising formats. Here's the interesting thing. I think you guys have a lot of power. If you remember the whole issue with viewability, that was not an ad tech choice, let me tell you. They had a great thing running for them, right? Let's charge them for something that's not happening. And that came from you guys. You put the foot down, and in fact, what you did is you choked the money, really, and said, listen, unless you figure this out, we're not spending money. And then all of a sudden, viewability solutions came about and such things. So I would say to you, you know, assuming you guys represent, you know, the more up and up advertisers, I'm going to assume you do, your agenda should be to create or to support a respectful advertising experience. It's a vague statement, but it's a respect, but it says a lot, doesn't it? And you need to put pressure on ad tech to do it, because let me tell you where it's not coming from. Ad tech. If you listen to the IAB, they're rabid crazy. The consumers cannot trust them for protection. They're up to their own thing. So interestingly enough, I think it might be the advertisers. We're putting pressure on the other end, okay, on the other side of the pipe. If, you know, you would like to collaborate and talk and figure out how to bring a better online advertising experience, you know, we'd be happy to meet and talk. But the common denominator of the conversation or any conversation should be a non-abusive, respectful online advertising experience.
Okay, I'm going to finish. We don't have time for any more questions, unfortunately. I moved into technology over 20 years ago. I was around before the first website came online, trawling through FTP sites on academic servers. I fell in love with the empowerment and the enabling that the internet could do with people, and how it could remove borders and be used for sharing knowledge, and really is a wonderful thing. I moved into privacy because I became concerned as to how technology was being abused and used to control and disempower people. So I think my message from this debate and from this discussion generally is to put that control back in the hands of users, to enable them, to empower them, to give them an experience that they can both enjoy but interact with at a level where they have the control. We have to put the consumers first. We have to think about the fact that these are the people who are going to buy these products at the end of the day that you're trying to advertise. And if you're annoying them, there's no way they're going to buy them. It's as simple as that. We have to put control back into the hands of the users. That's my purpose in getting involved in these discussions. It's my reason for working in privacy. And I'd like to think that everybody here would agree that consumers need to have control. Thank you very much for your time.